Good morning, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to our thought leadership session this morning. My name is Steve Pinner. For those of you that don't know, I'm the MD at Goodacre, and today I'm very pleased to be chairing this session, which is supported by Kidbrooke. I'm going to ask our speakers in a moment to introduce themselves, but just a couple of quick housekeeping things. The session is open to you all to ask questions, so please don't be timid in any way. Ask any questions that you'd like to in the usual way that happens on these Zoom sessions. For those of you that want copies of material that might be shown today, or certificated CPD after the event, just go to the Goodacre website, provide your feedback, and you will get the necessary information. So we're today talking about digitalising wealth management and how to build omnichannel customer journeys. And we're going to find out how that works out and what the benefits are of such an approach. And I'd now like, please, Fredrik Daveus and Joakim Petterson to make their own introductions, please.
Hello, I'm Fredrik Daveus, CEO and co-founder of Kidbrooke. Kidbrooke is a company that provides a financial simulation engine. It's API only, and it's all about creating interactive forecasts to help financial decision making and customers making better decisions.
Thanks, Fredrik. And Joakim?
Yes, hello everyone. Joakim Petterson, digital strategy and an innovation lead at Skandia. Skandia is a Swedish company. We prefer working in the life insurance business, but we also have a bank, and we specifically work, our core business is within the savings department, specifically in the pension or occupational pension, but all type of savings. And it's advisory heavy for our entire customer base, so to say.
Okay, thanks very much. So just to sort of set the context, really, there's an ongoing debate on physical, digital and hybrid business models in the industry. Today, we're discussing the omnichannel approach. Question is, how is this different from a hybrid approach, and why do modern wealth managers strive to adopt it? So if we can first of all ask... let's ask Fredrik if you can describe the nature of the partnership.
Before that, just want to touch quickly on the sort of omnichannel aspect. So I think if you compare the hybrid setup where you would have a setup where, you know, you would have a remote meeting or an advisor supporting the customer through some digital tools, I think the hybrid and the physical, purely physical face-to-face meeting situation is kind of merge over time. So I think the omnichannel we want to touch upon here is how to get sort of self-service digital experiences working together with any type of advisor-led approach, be it sort of remote or in the same room. And in terms of the partnership, I think we've had a great and very close partnership with Skandia over a number of years now. And we, as a tech provider, provide some of the sort of enabling technologies to be able to achieve this on the sort of automation of some of these outputs in terms of forecasts or this other types of decision support. But I think what's been great about the collaboration also has been that we've been able to work closely also in terms of jointly developing the actual customer experiences where we come in from sort of technology perspective and can explain what the technology can enable. And then obviously Skandia from their side has all the knowledge about their customers, what the main challenges and problems of the customers are, how their business and business models works, et cetera, et cetera. So from our perspective, it's been a very good collaboration.
And sorry, how long has that been in place, that partnership?
So I think it's been a number of years now. So the first, probably almost 4 years, but the first customer journeys that went live based on the outranked technology was sort of mid 2020.
Okay, fine. And just turning to you, Joakim, how would you describe this in terms of how it's helped Skandia? And you know, what sort of challenges and opportunities have come out of that?
Yeah. To start with, we had, of course, we are a company that is more than 150 years old, and we've been running advisory for a very long time, and it's been purely a physical thing for ages here in Skandia. And of course, the demands from the customers, etc., they start to demand digital tools. And we also wanted to be able to serve a lot more of our customers, because in the physical space, we couldn't reach them. We had to prioritize. And of course, you have to prioritize the customers with the most money. It's simple. But we would our aim was to be able to give advisory to all our customers. And that was the starting point here when we start discussing with Kidbrooke for 3.5-4 years ago, how do we do this? And that's when we looked in the market for technology solutions, etc., to help us doing this in both digital and a physical world. You always come up with platform solutions. It's wealth management platforms. It's holistic. It's big. You get a little bit of portfolio system. You get a little bit of CRM system. You get a little bit of risk, and you get everything in one portal and platform. But we have a lot of this already in-house from a technical point of view. What we were after was more the possibility to be able to visualize and calculate different type of economic scenarios, regardless of it's not only savings, it's the risk and health side of it, and that's what we found together with Kidbrooke here as a solution for the technical API flexible solution in the powerful economic scenario generator, pretty much, where we can use in different types of our business and in primarily within the advisory space.
Okay, thank you very much. That's interesting. In terms of sort of moving on, can we talk about managing the risks and the challenges involved?
So, yeah, I think from our perspective, obviously any sort of large transformation like this is difficult, right, and hard from many different aspects. So I think when it comes to manage these things, it's all about having a clear view of your roadmap, but then being able to chop that up into achievable steps to sort of maintain time to market. I think many of these projects, they are, you know, conceived to be very big, and then there's a long time before you actually start getting stuff out to the customers and start adding value. And then also the learning process about this is delayed, right? Because there's no input from the actual users, et cetera, et cetera. So, and to be able to keep up with the time to market, it's about decision-making, obviously, at the from management side point of view to keep that pace. But also, as Joakim touched upon in the previous or initial discussion here, that if you go with the big solution, which then requires you to replace, you know, CRM thing, replace portfolio systems, etc., it becomes very difficult to be more flexible and agile in the early days of the roadmap. So I think that's also one of the key benefits we see with our customers that are Skandia-like in terms of larger incumbent players with multiple business lines, that they can actually get started more quickly by introducing some of these decision-making outputs in terms of the forecast, et cetera, into various bits of existing technology and start to add value to customers early on.
Yeah, okay. And how do you address the infrastructural challenges that come up with this type of approach?
So maybe I just touch quickly on that, Joakim, before you can add your perspective. But I think one other key thing is that, you know, In all these bigger companies, there's always transformation projects going on, right? So the key is also to be able to start doing stuff without having to wait another 3 years before the core banking system is replaced or the core insurance system or, you know, these big transformation projects. So I think there it's also important not to be afraid to adapt, you know, slightly temporary solutions, maybe on the data side, to get some data up to be able to deliver some value to customers, and then sort of incorporate into the plan that once these bigger initiatives are delivered, you can then sort of off-ramp the temporary solutions and on-ramp them onto the more permanent long-term solutions. So I think that sort of flexibility of when you think about how to approach this is very important.
Sure. Can I just come back on one point before Joakim comes in on that? In terms of this type of approach, you're saying really that this type of approach is sort of agnostic in terms of what firms have got in that they may have legacy systems. I'm thinking of the wealth managers that are actually listening to this presentation today. A lot of these firms will have systems that have been developed a long time ago.
Yep.
And just how feasible is it that you can actually plug into those legacy systems to actually deliver this type of approach?
So I think almost, I mean, obviously there will be special cases where the technology is so old, so it's actually not possible to do anything other than what's being done at the moment, right? But in most cases, I think it's all about finding some key, well-defined space in your offering, how you can, you know, improve how you help your customers. It could be answering, you know, what will my likely pension income be or whatever, right? Or how will my money last through my, you know, foreseeable remaining lifetime or whatever, or how can I create a legacy in terms of wealth transfer? So everybody will know, you know, their core challenges that their customers face. And then I think it's about finding a way to meet that and add that value, right? And then if you're able to do some interactive front-end self-service journey, that's great. If your current technology stack is stopping that at the moment, you can find other ways of injecting this additional automated decision support output into your advisor's current workflow by, you know, giving them, say, proactive notifications, help them monitor their existing clients more efficiently, and just, you know, have this type of information being put out in these existing processes. And that can be done, we find, typically with minor technology efforts. Right. So I think it's all about being flexible in terms of how you decide to create the value once you know where you can sort of add to your customers' experiences.
Okay, and Joakim, in terms of, you know, putting this type of approach in, any system change comes with risks and challenges. And how did you get comfortable with that on your journey?
You never get comfortable with that, for sure, for sure. But of course, it's as I said, we are a company 150 years old. Of course, we have a challenge with our technology stack, and it's quite old in general. But what we were, as Fredrik talked a little bit about, we put quite an effort setting the vision and the roadmap. We spent quite a long time actually in setting that agenda before starting ripping up the technology, because we needed some long-term space here to be able to work and not to get money the first year and then the second year you're out of budget. That couldn't happen in this case, because then we couldn't run. So that put the pressure on do a quite thorough work in terms of the vision and the setting the roadmap to make sure to be able to start small and build from that.
Right.
And we build continuously capabilities in this space where we can actually put in different places in our business, both in the physical world, but also in the digital, and also not only advisory. A lot of these capabilities is also used in self-service channels in general here at Skandia. So the important place, and also to be able to do this, of course, you need to cater for your total infrastructure, and you have dependencies to old system, etc. But we also got a clear decision that we could build most of the technology on the side, so to say, and then put it in place because that was also important to be able to work with new technology and fast technology, to be able to do that with a focused team that is continuously working with only these type of questions and not switching team, etc. It's that running the entire roadmap here. And of course, more and more teams get involved now when it's getting bigger and bigger. But the central team is still in place since start, actually, that is responsible for this transformation.
Okay. All right. Well, thanks for that. Just a quick question that's come in from Eric Moe. Eric, good to see you or to hear from you. Eric has a question and he says, is your ROI calculation focused more on internal benefit or benefit to the clients or both? I don't know who would like to pick that up. Perhaps Joakim first.
Yeah, it's of course both, but mostly from the clients. It's both the clients, but not at least the regulators are on to every one of us to be transparent to our customers. And that is actually the key driver here as well from us, to be able to calculate the benefits for the customers. And that comes in all these type of solutions that we have, is primarily for the customers to understand what my money will become, and that should be realistic. That's why we have had quite tough demands on Kidbrooke here as well, to have a very sophisticated model that could cater for different type of tax rules depending on what type of scheme you're in, different type of fees, and etc. to make it very specific to the customer. The end results for the customers should always show including tax fees, etc., to be very transparent. And that should be the same across the channels. It shouldn't be different visualizations regardless of what channel we meet the customer.
Okay. Fredrik, do you want to add anything to that?
Yeah, so I think the couple of key aspects Joakim is mentioning here, I think the long-term view is very important, as I mentioned, and sort of plan for that and have an internal agreement on what the sort of holy grail would be that you're working on. And also, if you start by measuring the value as perceived by the customers, and you can obviously measure that through usage or feedback, etc. I think because the revenue side of things takes slightly longer to build up, because it's also a question of, I think we're way past the days where digital is something separate, right? It's just simply the new way of having that channel mix. It's going to be a hygiene factor in a few years. You need to meet the customer in the ways customer want to be met. And I think it also will take time to sort of add additional capabilities through all of the channels, and also maybe the bigger channels that sort of impact revenue the more, right? Because you typically maybe start with something smaller, well-contained. So I think that patience is key. Start looking at how the customers receives and perceives these things you do, and then revenue will follow. I think that's the way to approach it. Because if you put too heavy revenue measures in as the first, it's easy to lose that sort of long-term view, right? You're going to force you to take a too big approach initially, which would just increase the risk of the transformation.
Okay, fine. We're going to have some poll questions during the session. The first one is going to come up now. And so the question is, what is the most significant challenge faced, by your organization on your digital transformation journey? So you've got a few choices there, ranging from the lack of financial planning, outdated analytical and reporting capabilities, absence of the clear prioritization or direction of the digital transformation, the classification and storing of customer data, regulatory compliance issues, they always feature, or corporate cultural issues. So let's just give you a few seconds to go through your answers. Okay, so just a quick look down this list here. It seems to me that so the results are in, as they would say on Strictly. Looking at, I just want to extend my screen a little slightly. Hold on. Okay. So yeah, it's very interesting here that coming out on top seems to be corporate and cultural issues. And perhaps I could ask Fredrik to make some comments on the results of that poll.
Yeah, so I think it's a very important aspect, right? When you find this, and I think almost regardless of any change you're trying to impose on a corporate organization, there will be these issues, right, and challenges. And I think, again, coming back to what Joakim said, the initial sort of roadmap work and the strategic work, I think it's key to also be able to explain internally how this will pan out in the future, right? I think one thing maybe a few years back, maybe less common now, but still important factors is that people may feel threatened, either because they think, you know, this is going to impact my actual work or my, you know, the amount of work or the need the company will have for me, or if it will remove or take away responsibility. So I think there it's very clear. And I personally don't believe that technology will replace advisors, for example, right? Or replace other type of, it's more complementing and empowering and scaling these operations to be able to serve more customers. So I think it's very important to work on that, like education almost internally to explain what the benefits will be and be clear about any perceived risks
Before those results popped up there, Fredrik, would you have said that that's the biggest challenge?
I would. Actually, it's interesting because these top ones I thought were the absence of clear prioritization, which comes back to the roadmap work and the corporate culture issues. I think is typically two big things we see as well when we talk to potential customers. The first one, obviously, I firmly believe we are in a great position to help and mitigate. So,
of course.
But yeah.
If I can just flick over to Joakim, I mean, in your organisation, Joakim, I mean, you've obviously overcome these particular issues in this approach. But was there much resistance?
Yeah, of course, and I understand the questions here. What was surprisingly is the regulatory compliance issues is quite low. But of course, if you haven't taken the three top one here before, then you will probably get to the compliance issues after that. but of course, that's a challenge. But I understand this, and as Fredrik said, it's of course when you start discussing this. Okay, now we need to take this advisory part digital, fully digital. Of course, you get a little bit of resistance in the organization, it's primarily from the advisory side. That's okay, but I have my clients here. Will I lose them? Or you get a little bit of fear there. And when you start working with these advisors and actually showing them what it means, we have them on board now, and they are screaming for more and more capabilities now, because what they see, they can actually, we give them tools to use against the customers. And as Fredrik says, we will never, at least for now, get rid of our physical advisors. We need them by far. We definitely need them because it's not fully, to make this fully self-service is very hard when it comes to conversion rates, etc. So we see the combination here. We need it, but we need to have very powerful tools for the advisors to use against the customers. And of course, the tools that are very powerful have more bells and whistles in the physical channel than there is in the digital channel. It's more simplified, but it's the same base technology side that is in both channels. But the advisor have more bells and whistles connection to it than the self-service channels have. But yeah, that is true.
And I also think here, so not only empowering the advisors, and I agree with that reaction that Joakim describes there, that when you show what is possible and how they can make the meetings more interactive and fun in a sense, even high net worth advisors and relationship managers really jump on this and thinks it's great. But then the other aspect is also to be able to achieving that omnichannel setup where you have the self-service tools, which can still answer questions and in a realistic manner, you also allow both customer to self-select which channel meets their needs the best at the moment. But you, and the consistency will allow you to allow the customers to move between these channels, right? Because you can start out self-educating in the Skandia self-service pension advice journeys. Maybe, you know, set up a small additional private pension investment scheme to complement your state and occupational benefits. And then you can go on a few months later when you feel comfortable that you understand the situation, meet the fiscal advisor, get that extra comfort, maybe and ask a few more complicated questions related to your, you know, other more complicated tax setups or inheritance questions, etc. What kind of family protection you need. And then, you know, customers convert faster and easier because they've started the journey self-service. And then you will be able to manage and optimize the time spent by the fiscal advisors to increase your revenue even more.
Yeah, looking at that poll very quickly, and we'll move on in a second, but I think if you worry about or if there's a cultural issue about moving forward with this type of approach, you've probably got people around you that actually think what they're doing today is fine. Why change? It might be the fear of change. There might be the people thinking that there's a perception out there that this might impact their jobs or whatever. But what we're talking about here is something I think that's going to enhance the proposition and actually make for an easier and more customer effective solution. So I think there's a bit of a fear factor in that one as well. But anyway, we'll move on if we may. We can talk about transform. Let me just get rid of the poll for a second. Let's talk about transformation results and learnings. How's it going? We could ask Fredrik to open up on this one.
So I think early on, I think one specific thing was that it was the older customer groups that converted and used the digital self-service tools more than younger customers. I think that was interesting because it sort of went against some of the typical understandings, I think, in the industry at the time. And I think that sort of may have sort of developed. So by now, I think it's not, you know, people don't perceive that as strange, really, especially for pension related things and stuff where being older, it's more relevant for you, obviously, or more of a pressing concern, perhaps. Mm-hmm. Then I think also the level of feedback Skandia received throughout these journeys where, I mean, this has been one of our core beliefs, really, that if you have a true aim to help the customer answer, you know, what really questions that really matter to them and do that in a realistic fashion and not assume that just because they are mass affluent or retail, they will not understand or be able to take in the information. I think that is very, very nice type of learnings for us to sort of see that in reality and see some data on that. That if you take that approach, people will understand the value, they will engage more, and they will actually ask you for more features to even better understand their financial situation.
Okay. And were there results that surprised you, by the way?
So I think that age group thing initially was interesting to see that older customers use digital self-service tools to that extent. If I were surprised or not about the type of feedback, obviously we were hoping that these sort of core beliefs of ours were indeed correct, right? So, but yeah.
Okay, and Joakim, any surprises for you from this aspect?
Yeah, I would say Fredrik mentioned one, the older customer base was quite a surprise, actually, that it was the biggest customer group that used the digital channels. That wasn't really what we thought, but the other thing that we learned quite that was very interesting was that, of course, you always want to, you are measured with, okay, what is your conversion in the digital channel? How much do you sell, et cetera, et cetera. That is something that you, day one, have to be able to answer. But what we learned was that our customers, regardless of if they had a physical advisor or not, used the digital channels to educate themselves in these type of tools before getting into a physical meeting or being comfortable with sitting together with an advisor, because they felt a little bit stupid in taking this discussion directly with the advisor. So they used the digital channels to see, okay, this is how it works, and now I understand a little bit more. And then they converted in a hybrid or a physical channel together with an advisor.
That's very interesting. And so yeah. Can I just pick up one point? Sorry to interrupt, but on the age thing there, you said, yeah. did you say that you were surprised with the older customers that you've got actually getting involved with this? Can you give us a bit more detail around that?
Yeah, of course, because as I said, we have the history of a physical advisory. Of course, the older a customer gets, the more money they have. So many of the older customers that we have also is relevant for the physical advisory. So that was the surprise. We actually built the digital tools for the others that is not there. but then we saw that they were there because, and that is also connected to the interest of course. We are heavy in the pension side, the occupational pensions, and of course the interest of pension questions is maybe not the funniest thing to discuss when you are in the 25 or 30 years old. It's of course it gets more and more relevant for the older one to so the interest is running that pretty much as well. But
I think I just wanted to sort of amplify that point, because there is a school of thought that says, you know, these digital applications are more attractive to the younger generations, and I'm not, I think that's actually passing us by now, because people expect things to be made available. People want instant responses. They don't want to wait on the telephone for information. They actually want to get their information. And interesting that you say people are using this approach to actually prepare themselves for a more detailed discussion. It actually empowers them because they've got the information.
Yeah, and we also can see that the ones that actually convert also in the digital channels have been in the same flow for two, maybe the second and third time they convert in the same flow. So they are not doing it from A to Z in one go. They go in, okay, think about, okay, I get back tomorrow or something. So the third time, then we convert the self-service customers as well.
Okay, I've got to ask one quick follow up if you don't mind.
Yeah.
Any resistance from customers?
Yeah, of course. it's still like insurance and it's pension we are talking about. It's not the funniest thing, and it's not in the thing that is top of mind all the time. So of course we have challenges in getting this type of questions interesting enough for the customers to actually convert and understand it. That's the biggest challenge I see for us, because we are not the Netflix, we are not the Spotify, we are not selling Teslas, we are not it's insurance and it's savings. It's not always that fun, and that's a challenge for us to make it appealing for the customers and to understand it, what it means to actually start early and building capital.
That's
a challenge.
And I just want to add to that, which I think one thing Skandia has done really well is to acknowledge the value of having the realistic engine and calculations powering these outputs, right? Because I think that's key also to build the trust in the self-serve channel, that you can get really sort of answers to questions you have as a customer. But then to separate that sort of necessary complexity with the fact that it has to be presented in an easy to use and simple way, right? So even though you only in some of these journeys, you simply publish a single number. So it's very easy to digest. This is just one figure, right? But it doesn't take away from the understanding that the figure has to be realistic and you know, as accurate as possible. And I think that's a great, and you need to sort of get into that way of thinking to be successful.
And I can add on that, because that's a very, that's a question that we have discussed millions of times internally here. Why do we have the monster engine here if we only serve a number to the customer? And that is back to the transparency side of it, because we have a lot of different views on how should we calculate. We need to make it very correct. And when we scale it, the simple number that we're maybe showing in some area, it's the same number that we're showing in the advisory tool, but you can see a lot more. So that's the reason for it. And also we have, of course, an asset management department that demands, okay, the views of this scenario engine have to be in place as the our views. So they have also input to the technology that we get from Kidbrooke in how to be able to control this in one or another way. So it takes a lot to even do the simple stuff when you should scale it.
Sure. And Fredrik, the learnings that Joakim's touched on at Skandia, are they consistent with your other customers?
I think for similar type of customers where you have this sort of, you know, quite a large number of customers and it's like more mass affluent ordering and retail, I think this is consistent. And then obviously if you go to other types of customers, more smaller companies in themselves and maybe more of a single line of business, so think the traditional wealth manager or financial advisor, then learnings are different, right? Because it's just the different beast really compared to this. And in those cases, consistency across channels may be less of an issue because, you know, they do one thing, right? So,
Okay. So let's move on to our next poll question, please. So here we go. How much attention does your board or your senior management devote to the digital transformation of your wealth business? So don't worry, we're not going to send all these results back to the senior management, but it'd be interesting to know what you feel. So you've got a few choices there. I don't think anyone knows about it. It's an ambition, but we haven't got the right capabilities. They engage, but not consistently. I wish actions were monitored and followed through. And there's a designated leader responsible for the digital channel, and it's a regular agenda item at board and senior management level. Interesting. I'll just give you a few seconds to address that. Okay, so I think we're more or less there now. And coming out on top, looks like they do engage, but not consistently. Actually, right at the top there, I don't think anyone thinks about it. Nobody went for that. But there's not a consistent approach. And for me, interesting, there's a designated leader responsible for the digital channel, and it's a regular agenda item. Interesting that. I just wonder whether that's more slanted towards the larger firms. Not sure, but perhaps Fredrik can talk us through his comments on that poll.
Yeah, so I think if you would have done, and then we would have done sort of these similar services a few years back, I think you would have a different outcome here in the poll. I think this is more and more the case. I think that people are very aware of that, you know, these things are becoming more of a required thing to have self-service channels or good digital tools, you know, across your channels. So I think the bottom one is actually not that surprising. Maybe the they do engage, but not consistently is a bit surprising that that's still quite a big chunk of responses.
And in your experience, Fredrik, when you're talking to prospective users of your services, do you come across, you know, the one man that's actually given the task, or is it normally coming down from senior management that they want to get involved? You know, what's the level of it?
I think it's typically a combination. I think conversations with senior management are always useful to sort of understand the agenda and the priorities of the potential customer, right? Because I said sometimes you have such legacy issues or other pressing regulatory things, or you've been through some M&A, you know, bought another company, whatever. So there is actually stuff that has a naturally high priority. But then when it comes to understanding how technology can be deployed, I think it's super valuable to get into conversations with a number of people across the organization, right, which sort of comes from different areas of it. And we see this also in some of the conversations with bigger incumbents. Typically, once you know the interest is there, it's kind of a structured product process where they sort of gather almost a temporary dedicated team, in a sense, to have this conversation with us, for example, to understand how they can use and benefit from the technology. And I think that that way of sort of starting the collaboration benefits us as well. It's good. You get to properly understand each other, where you come from, what the priorities are, how one can help and work together.
Okay. And Joakim, you're obviously a long way down the road on this particular approach. How's your structure changed, or has your structure changed to accommodate these types of developments internally?
That's always a challenging question. But if we go back to the senior management, it's of course they are very here and now as well. And what's the results? And as I said, we started this journey with putting some ground sticks in the ground and said, okay, this is a long journey. It's you cannot remove my budget next year because you want to do something else, because we haven't any effects the first year, maybe. It has to be a long-term perspective. And that's the challenge here, because they are, of course, chasing me every day. I mean, what's the result? What's the result?
Yeah, yeah.
And it's not good enough. We are spending a lot of money, but it's not good enough. Yeah. And then we need to be able to point back to the vision and where we are going. And of course, we have been able to put some results on the table as well. But it's a longer journey that they need to be able to see into, and not only year by year or quarter by quarter that, okay, this is not good enough. And they always ask, when are we done? We're never done with the digital transformation.
Yeah,
for sure. It's an ongoing journey. So that's all. I understand the challenges here. And of course, the challenges in the organization, in the different business silos, is also a big challenge that we are working with quite a lot, actually, still, to be able to do that, lift that to the customer level and see, okay, can we just agree on this is what the customer wants, regardless of the different product silos? That's always a discussion, and that is a challenge.
And Fredrik, could I come back to you just on this? And how has demand changed before the pandemic and since?
So I think it's super interesting, actually, because if you go back before the pandemic, I think a lot of times when we talk to people and potential customers, there was actually a bit of a blank stare coming back, right? Okay, why are you doing this? What's like, just why? And then pandemic hits and people are starting to put in place hygiene factors like video conferencing, and finding new ways of working. And I think a lot of those basic capabilities were put in place as well during the pandemic. So, and during that time, I think when you had these conversations, it was more like, okay, yeah, this is a pretty cool solution actually, but okay, what's the killer app or what's the real deal here? Mm. And coming out of the pandemic, I think once many of those basic digital capabilities were in place, people are now starting to, and has been for a while, right, looking for content to fill self-service channels with or fill new infrastructure with. And then it's, 9 out of 10 these days is like, okay, yeah, obviously everybody must have these capabilities, at some point or another. And this is like obvious to people why it has value. So I think it's been a super interesting period of time seeing that development in the market and people's sort of minds shifting and focusing onto these things. And also just touching upon Joakim's comment there quickly, in terms of you're never done, right? Because I think this is all about, it's not going to be a separate digital thing. As we touched upon earlier in this conversation, it's going to be the way you do business going forward, right? And then you're never going to be done doing business development. You're never going to be done optimizing your way of selling things to people, right? That's just asking like, okay, when will we close down the company? It's just not going to happen if you're a going concern, right?
Controversially, I just want to mention something. I actually think that a number of organisations fell behind the curve before the pandemic and actually did not focus enough on technological opportunities and got comfortable with what they had. I think, whereas if I go back a long time, I think financial services were at the leading edge of technology developments, and I think that fell away, certainly in the UK. I think the pandemic was a bit of a prompt, that necessity being the mother of invention, people had to embrace this to move forward. And actually, as they've embraced it, they people are actually beginning to see the real benefits. Anyway, let's move on, if we may. Can we talk now, please, about maintaining the client relationship ownership and improving the customer engagement? And can I turn to you, Joakim, first on that one?
Yeah, of course. It's what we wanted to do is to have these more automated solutions in place to be able to be very proactive and specific to each client in terms of communication. It's notifications that is specifically directed to your portfolio. And it's not, because it's very hard to get interest in broad messages around the market is very cumbersome right now. Everyone knows that. But what's in it for me, there is where we use this type of technology as well for each client. What does it actually mean for my portfolio? What should I do now? Those type of question is something that we are digging more and more into. We have some capabilities in place already, but we need to widen that type of and that will also help, because these type of notifications, in some cases, if it is a physical client, maybe that type of notification goes to the advisor rather directly to the customer. It depends on how you want to steer this dialogue with the customer, but to have the capabilities in place is something that we are working very much with now to be able to be very relevant when we speak to our customers.
And can I just sort of add a quick question that's come in from one of the attendees here? I've just come in. It says, do firms like Skandia and others like mine, this is from Eric Vink here, need to reach externally for software tools, etc. Is it the only way to really keep up to date? And he also said, regards to Stephen and Frederick, by the way. So that's me and you, Frederick. So Eric Vinken. So could you comment on that, please, Joakim? He says, you know, do you need to reach externally for the software and the tools? Is that essential?
Yeah, it's for us, it was pretty easy to decide that, okay, this type of functionality is not something that we build ourselves. We don't have the possibility to have the competence in place all the time. And so that's the reason why we ended up with Kidbrooke, actually, in this type of space, because it's not part of our core business. It's a very vital part to be able to run our core business. But for us to build it ourselves, internally, was not this scenario generator functionality was not possible. We actually started in that space with Kidbrooke as consultants, etc. But it was not possible. But what we wanted to have ourselves is the customer experience. Yeah. We need to be able to control the customer experience, not the technology behind it. Yeah. So that's the borderline that we put in place here.
Okay, and Frederick, coming to you, how do you think wealth managers can encourage engagement?
Yes, I think there is some aspects, like Joakim says, and this obviously depends on your internal capabilities, right? Some firms will have the capabilities of building these tools, I'm sure, but then I guess you always have anything you build internally, right? You have to not just look at the cost of building it, you have to look at the cost of maintaining it and maintaining a big enough team over time to actually be able to keep that knowledge and develop it internally, right? So, but if, I mean, of course, some may think or believe that that's the best in the, you know, good for them. And I don't really have an opinion there. It's just you have to judge every case individually. The other aspect, I think, if you do choose to buy externally, I think it's very important to think about the customization and flexibility, because as Joakim says, you want to own the customer experience. And you also want to provide services and value to customers in line with the brand and, you know, who Skandia is, and what is the Skandia way of delivering advice, etc. And there, I think it's very important, coming back to house use, as we discussed previously, coming back to configuration in terms of how, you know, advice provided by machines or next best actions or notifications provided by the machine, what is the actual output? How does it work? And what kind of recommendations does it provide? So if you use external technology, make sure you can control that, because otherwise it's in the market, if several providers use the same technology provider, it's all going to be the same, right? Which doesn't really make sense. And the other aspects in terms of also coming back to API versus finished sort of white labelable platforms or services is that having that, you also kind of lose that control sometimes over the experience. But if you want to do more things than just what this particular use case is for, you know, unless that's flexible enough to provide for all of your use cases, you're going to buy another, you know, you have one robo solution over here, you have another advice provider for the advisors tools, etc., then that consistency becomes very difficult to achieve. So from that perspective, I think if you're able to use API based modules in your sort of overall system or tech stack, that's very beneficial from that point of view to be able to achieve consistency where it matters.
Do you have any views on how the managers can encourage engagement digitally?
So I think that really comes down again to, like, sometimes I feel the question about engagement is overcomplicated, right? Because I think if you have a situation where a customer, and this goes across any type of service or product, right? If the customer perceives value for money in the individual specific case, customers typically are engaged, right? Or they, at least they continue to buy from you or buy more, right? So I think it's that's where you have to start. Okay, so how can you provide value to customers for your specific services that you provide? In this case, typically wealth management, financial advice, you know, pension, investments, what have you. And then sort of go from there, right? And then it comes back to, okay, maybe we have a situation where we can create value, but it's completely priced in the wrong way. And I think you've seen that also historically, say pension or occupational pensions, right? Or financial advice, you get some very good service up front, you get into some scheme, but then the ongoing fees are pretty high compared to the value you extract from this, right? So if you have, you know, if you're mid, say you're 50 years old and you have had an occupational and private pension savings and investments for your career, you will have accumulated a decent size, right, of capital. And then there might be 1%, 2% fees on this ongoing, and you can work that out in dollars, right? And then have a think, do I actually value this thing as much as, you know, I'm paying for it on an ongoing basis? And then it comes back to, how can you be more cost efficient if that's your conclusions? How can you sort of have the technology in place to deploy your typically more expensive human resources into this situation, right? More efficiently. How can you monitor and continue to add value, as Joakim was talking about, by using technology in a smart way?
Okay. So if we can move on in the interest of time, can we have a look at the future now? So the vision for the future, how analytics can help you get there. Forecasting technology, what's your recommendations here, or what are your comments about how we're all going to arrive for the optimum solution?
Maybe just quickly, I think if you look at the forecast itself, or the ability to project things into the future, you know, keeping in mind uncertainty. So I think it's given the nature of finance, right? It's not physics, so it's obviously impossible to predict accurately what will happen. But what you can do is try to estimate uncertainty, right? And see what ifs, etc. What will happen if I do this? Or what may happen? What is the best worst case, etc. I think that kind of input is is fundamental also to humans, right? So if you think about Google Maps, for example, these sort of services that help you find your way, even if you know the route, right, and you drive it maybe a few times a year, whatever, to your in-laws, for example, whatever, you're still typically going to have a look at your GPS for, you know, what is the traffic situation today, get some kind of forecast about what you're about to do, right? And I think this goes broadly applicable as humans. It's kind of interesting to have that capability of understanding what may happen in the future. So that's why I think the ability to do forecasts in this space, and then obviously everything that can be derived from the forecast has a potential to provide great customer value.
Okay. And Joakim, can I just come in with a quick question, because I'm conscious of time here. It's a question that's coming from Robin Copley, actually for you, Joakim, again. Robin says, does Skandia communicate with its clients via the client's medium of choice in order to same time for advisors, relationship managers, encourage client engagement and develop a more personal customer experience, ? For example, that's moved up there. For example, via WhatsApp, as well as more traditional forms like email in person. So does Skandia communicate with its clients via the client's medium of choice in order to, at the same time, for advice? I think, I'm not sure if I'm understanding the question properly there. So he wants to know what medium you're allowing your clients to communicate with.
Both yes or no. We are into that to be able to be very customer specific, be able to set these type of preferred channels, etc., for the customers. But as we see, the complexity there is because the customer probably want to go to move along between these type of channels. For in one session they might want to be together with the physical advisors, but in other areas they want to be fully digital, and to be able to serve customer in to be able to change this type of communication channels is quite hard, because that will be the entire business model but needs to cater for that in times of pricing, but we are into it, and I understand that the question comes because it's a challenge to actually cater for it in all the different solutions here. But definitely we are looking into it, and it's also a big connection to the regulators, etc. How are we allowed to communicate with each customers in different types of questions? Yes or no? No, not always, and not if we haven't asked the customer permission to do it, and the permission could be different depending on what type of product it is, etc. So it's quite complex. So I understand definitely the question, and we are into the question and working on with it. But to fully say yes, that we can steer the communication in the choice of the channel that the customer choose. No, not in a general perspective, but in some areas, yes.
Okay, and just generally speaking, Joakim, how's the Kidbrooke solution impacted your operational efficiency since you've moved along with this?
I shouldn't say that we are nearly finished with our roadmap here. We are into it, and we can see that what we thought was is actually correct. So we are using that as it says here. We use this technology for different life events, because the challenge for us is to make sure that the customer understand why should I have this type of insurance, for example, protection or something. Why should I have it? Everyone knows that they should have it, but what is the impact on my economy or my balance sheet if I don't have it? So that's where we are working more and more now, is to be able to show the customers the value that we have in the product and the service around it. because it's hard to sell these type of products. I'm sorry, insurance is boring for all customers, but you need to be able to show why it's important and how it affects me. And it's the same for if you can combine the different life events here, like mortgage and protection and savings in one view, then you have something powerful. The complexity in that is to make sure that the customer understand what they're looking at. That's the nut to actually solve.
Okay, I'm really conscious of time, but I just want to leave the last quick question to Fredrik, if I may. So Fredrik, can you in a quick comment, just advise wealth managers how they can future-proof their infrastructure?
So I think it comes down to more on the qualitative side, having that roadmap discussions and align internally, and then try to find a way to start small and go for modular API-based building blocks as much as possible. Don't wait until the big transformations necessarily are all done, because it might be multiple years. So try to get started early and start the learning process, because that continuous learning, including learnings from customers, is super valuable, I think, to guide you and sort of your adjustments on your future roadmap over time.
Thanks very much. Well, look, it's been we could go on for a long time, but I'm conscious of time, and people, when they're on Zooms, they want us to run to time. So look, Fredrik, Joakim, very good. Thank you very much for your input. We will be following this session up with a communication, with a summary. And as I said earlier on, we can provide the slides and CPD certification if necessary, just by logging onto the Goodacre website. But I found that interesting. And it's always good to have a real live customer talking about their experiences. And so thanks very much for your insights. Have a great day, and I'm sure we'll be following this up in the not too distant. But a very good to you all. Bye-bye now.
Thank you very much.